that is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is the most common heritable cardiomyopathy. It is not so uncommon in general population. 1 in 500 people can have this disease, and it is the most common cause of sudden death in young. And around 1% of patients with HCM can have sudden cardiac death. The mode of presentation can be quite variable: asymptomatic, syncope, angina, heart failure, cardiac arrest, or sudden cardiac death can be the modes of presentation. Next slide.
Please go to the presentation view.
Yeah, full screen you can go. Yeah,
full screen view.
So if you look at the pathophysiology of HCM, due to the disease in sarcomeric proteins and non-genetic modifiers, there is myocyte hypertrophy and disarray. This leads to fibrosis and also small vessel remodeling, resulting in small infarcts and further fibrosis. The resultant is LVH diastolic dysfunction, LVOT obstruction due to a thickened septum, and various forms of arrhythmias. All this combined to produce symptoms like dyspnea, which may result in heart failure, chest pain, syncope, palpitations, and obviously the dreaded complication of sudden cardiac death. Now, if you look at the signs, due to forceful contraction, patient may present with a brisk pulse. In obstructive variety, we can get a Visfradian pulse with spike and dome pattern, forceful apex, double or triple apical impulse, S4, prominent A wave in JVP due to significant LVH. Close differential diagnosis is the valvular aortic stenosis, which also present with similar symptoms. So the systolic murmur in HCM, HOCM of LVOT obstruction increases with standing and maneuvers like Valsalva strain, unlike that in aortic stenosis, and also the radiation of aortic stenosis murmur to the carotids. These are, and the anacrotic pulse in aortic stenosis. These are some of the clinical findings which help us differentiate between the two. Next slide. So if we broadly classify HCM, one form is with LVOT obstruction, significant LVOT gradient of more than 30 at rest or 50 with provocation, and without LVOT obstruction. Though the form of HCM without LVOT obstruction is less symptomatic, however, we should remember that the LVOT obstruction is not the most strong predictor of SCD. There are other things we should look at, and even a patient without HOCM can have increased risk of SCD, as we will discuss later. Next. So defining HCM, abnormal thickening of ventricular walls in absence of abnormal loading conditions like systemic hypertension, valvular heart disease. And more than 15 by echo, CT or cardiac MR, and in first degree relative, more than or equal to 13 is also sufficient to label it as HCM. However, we will have to rule out systemic hypertension, valvular and subvalvular AS, and infiltrative cardiomyopathies at least. So various forms are there. Asymmetrical septal hypertrophy is more common. However, apical hypertrophy, concentric hypertrophy, lateral wall, right ventricular involvement, apical aneurysm, and worn out HCM are also not so uncommon. Next slide. So we look at the etiology. Around 40 to 60% have documented sarcomeric protein gene mutation, among which myosin binding protein C3 mutation and myosin heavy chain 7. These are the two common forms. 5 to 10% have various storage disorders, mitochondrial diseases, and of which Fabry disease, Friedreich's ataxia, and amyloidosis deserve special mention. However, you can see that a large chunk, 25 to 30% of patients, the etiology remains unknown. Next slide. So talking about genetics in family, the role of genetics is now mainly limited to family screening. A patient of HCM is identified, he should undergo a genetic study to detect mutation, or at least of the common mutations which have been discovered so far. So if he is positive for mutation, the other family members should be screened for that mutation. It is the preferred method. All first degree family members should be of a HCM patient should undergo this screening. And the predictors of a positive result is age less than 45, maximal wall thickness more than 20, family history of HCM, obviously, family history of SCD, reverse curved septum shape, and the absence of systemic hypertension. Next slide. So this chart roughly shows us that what should be the frequency of family screening. If a patient is having genetic mutation negative, or the mutation is not detected due to some reason, due to unavailability, so the less than 12 years, we should start screening only if there is malignant family history, cardiac symptom, is engaging in competitive sports, or till the age of 21, every 12 to 18 months. After that, when adulthood is reached, every 5 years is enough, unless there are some high-risk features for which we should want more frequent monitoring. Next slide. So, let's take a case scenario. 16-year-old male, state-level athlete, asymptomatic routine evaluation reveals LVH in hypo, septal thickness of 13. Father had a history of sudden death at the age of 40. So, what should be our diagnosis? Next slide. So this is a very common diagnostic dilemma, athlete's heart versus HCM. The points favoring HCM, LVH more than 12, asymmetric or focal LVH, accompanying diastolic dysfunction, extensive late gadolinium enhancement in CMR, these are electro ECG patterns, family history of HCM, more than mild LA enlargement and reduced oxygen consumption on exercise. And points favoring athlete's heart are less than 12 millimeter LVH, uniform LVH, mild LVH enlargement with eccentric LVH, absence of diastolic dysfunction and absence of LGE and hypertrophy regression with activity cessation. Another important diagnostic dilemma is hypertension and HCM, which often coexist. So features favoring hypertension are a normal or just ECG with LVH pattern without the repolarization abnormality of the T wave and regression of LVH over 6 to 12 months after tight VP control. Next slide. So we can see ECG can play a very important role in diagnosing HCM. Normal ECG is not so common, only 6% of patients can have normal ECG. LVH with associated SKT changes is quite common. Pseudo infarct pattern with deep narrow dagger like Q waves in lateral more than inferior leads, we can see in the right bottom picture, pseudo infarct pattern. And giant precordial T wave inversion in apical HCM, the right upper picture, we can see. LA enlargement suggestive of diastolic dysfunction, signs of WP syndrome, and several dyspneas, most common being atrial fibrillation. Up to 20% of patients with HCM can have atrial fibrillation, SVTs, various forms, VPCs, PSEs, and of course VT, which can be sustained or non-sustained, and can often and can also degenerate into VF, which can lead to sudden cardiac death. So role of echocardiography, we have already discussed some important points is in pediatric population. More than 2 standard deviation is considered significant LVH. There is stepwise increase in SCD risk with increasing wall thickness. And contrast enhanced imaging may be helpful in apical and HCM and apical aneurysm. And role of strain imaging in subclinical case. And it can it may be useful, and also it helps to differentiate between amyloidosis, which has an apical sparing pattern, in strain imaging. And the other role of echocardiography is mitral valve assessment, aortic valve assessment, and diastolic dysfunction assessment. Higher grades of diastolic dysfunction bearing worse prognosis. Next. So we can see the various forms of LVH. The normal pattern of ventricular walls, opposed to the asymmetric septal hypertrophy, the apical hypertrophy, the symmetric concentric type of hypertrophy, the mid capillary muscular hypertrophy, which can give rise to a mid cavity gradient, and the different types of septal shapes. The sigmoid septum, the reverse septum, which has a strong correlation with genetic mutation, the neutral septum, and the apical variety. Now, if you look on the database of Mayo Clinic, up to 41% of patients can have a resting gradient of more than 30, and another 27 can have a provocable gradient of more than 30, and non-obstructive HCM constitutes 23%. Apical HCM and mid-cavitary obstruction constitute the rest. Next. So echo images, plaques view all three, showing the different forms of asymmetrical septal hypertrophy. The sigmoid septum to the bulge in the basal septum, the neutral septum, and the reverse cuff septum. Next. Apical HCM, we can see that in the first picture, the basal septum is quite thin, but as we go towards apex, it is becoming thick. In the short axis view, the LV lumen is almost obliterated, and the contrast imaging helping us with the clear delineation of the endocardial border in apical HCM. And apical HCM with an aneurysm is associated with higher chances of heart failure, death, NSVT, SCD, in ICD shock, generation and also cardioembolic stroke. Next. Next, these are we have already discussed. So now assessment of the LVOT obstruction. We can see that in HCM, IHOCM, unlike the normal LVOT, the thickening of the septum and the abnormal predisposition of the papillary muscle and subvalvular apparatus pulls the mitral apparatus, especially the AML, towards the septum. We can see in the beginning of ejection, there is not so much apposition and there is also not so much gradient. But as ejection continues, there is SAM, that is a systolic anterior motion of the anterior mitral leaflet, which further narrows the LVOT, which is also narrowed by the encroaching thickened septum. And there is generation of a LVOT gradient. And due to malapposition, due to the anterior motion of the mitral leaflet, there is a MR, which is typically posteriorly directed jet. And if a MR is present, which is not a posterior jet, then further inquiry may be may be helpful to see what is the actual reason of MR, because it may bear importance in the surgical management. Next slide. So we have already discussed that due to drag effect and Venturi effect, there is anterior displacement of the mitral valve and the other factors, papillary muscle, caudal attachments, which are abnormal in HCM, all give rise to the development of LVOT gradient. And we can see the arrow that it is showing the SAM, that is anterior mitral leaflet opposing the septum in systole, which should be demarcated from pseudo SAM, other causes of other conditions which mimic SAM, like hypertension, amyloidosis, posterior wall infarct, etc. And if we put a CW, continuous wave Doppler, we can see that it is shifting from a tongue-shaped shadow of MR to a more dagger-shaped shadow of HOCM towards the right. And both coexist very frequently. Next slide. So, we have now seen the echo changes, ECG changes and echo changes. So, a 50-year-old lady, non-diabetic, non-motensive, with heart failure in my HA2-3, occasional dizziness on exertion, non-specific acidity in there, coming with asymmetrical septal hypertrophy with a thickness of 18 mm, preserved LV ejection fraction, no LVOT gradient at rest and pulsar lasting. So, should we label her as an HCM without obstruction? Next slide. Actually, no. We should follow a stepwise approach. Especially in symptomatic patient, even after Valsalva, if you are not getting a gradient, you can go for amyl nitrate inhalation and also stress, exercise stress or dobutamine stress. And last option is CAT study to see whether actual obstruction is there or not, because a LVOT gradient of more than 50 dictates the line of management and septal reduction therapies come into play. Next slide. So we have already discussed the clinical DDs, cardiovascular DDs, hypertension, aortic stenosis, athlete's heart. Some other DDs we can discuss, like non-compaction and amyloidosis. Next slide. Non-compaction, we can see mimicking apical HCM. Actually, these are the sinusoids. If we put color, we can see the blood flowing through the sinusoid, which is actually due to non-compaction. Fabry's disease, due to lysosomal glycogen storage disorder, it is due to deposition of glycolipids in the interstitial spaces. And hyperdiffractile lateral subendocardial border is often suggestive, although often endomyocardial biopsy is required. Amyloid, we can see the hyperdiffractile spots throughout the myocardium, often called the starry sky appearance with typical low voltage ECG. Next slide. So often, as we can see, ECG and echo is not enough, and cardiac MR plays a pivotal role in the diagnosis of HCM. Not only diagnosis, also in confirmed cases, it can detect extensive left gadolinium enhancement, apical aneurysm, extensive LVH, and also in the management aspect, septal morphology for planning surgery, mitral valve anatomy, whether mitral valve intervention is required, and localizing the obstruction. All these are helped by a proper cardiac MR study. So a patient with HCM should do at least one cardiac MR during the evaluation process. Next slide. Late gadolinium enhancement is very important, in the sense, though it is not specific, it is a marker of myocardial fibrosis, but it is not specific to HCM, and it often fails to detect diffuse expansion. However, it has definitely some prognostic significance. Extensive LG is associated with a fall in EF, NSVT and also increased mortality. And LG more than 15% is associated with twofold increase in SCD events. Next slide.
Bashab, time.
So we can use ECG, echo, and LG and the T1 relaxation time in CMR to differentiate between the different VDs, the infiltrative cardiomyopathies. Next slide. Cardiac cath has a historic role, no doubt, but now due to advanced non-invasive methods, its role has become quite limited. However, if we fail to establish LVOT gradient by non-invasive tests, it can be used. And in transplant patients, waiting for transplants, terminal patients, it has a role. The lower panel showing the classical Brockenborough-Bronwell sign, that is post-PVC, there is a fall in the pulse volume and the pulse pressure. Unlike
that time,
the role of endomyocardial biopsy is only in if infiltrative and inflammatory storage disease is suspected. Next. So a patient with only frequent VPCs and echo features of HCM controlled with metoprolol, and the symptoms is controlled. Is this the adequate management, or we should do something more? Next slide. So management of HCM, though it has no cure, should comprise of sudden cardiac death risk stratification, management of heart failure, management of LVOT obstruction, management of atrial fibrillation, and some future directions in management are coming up. Next slide. So SCD, sudden cardiac death in HCM, there is an arrhythmogenic myocardial substrate due to myocyte disarray, coronary artery remodeling, there is small microinfarction and fibrosis. The SCD risk is overall 0.5 to 1%, but maximum risk is in those patients having cardiac arrest or sustained VT or VF. 10% per year risk is there. And primary risk factors are SCD in first degree relative, unexplained syncope, massive LVH more than 30, NSVT, abnormal VT response, and some other features like LG in CMR, apical aneurysm, burnout HCM, LVOT gradient more than 30 have some role in choosing the correct patient. So avoiding competitive sport, ICD implantation when appropriate form the mainstay of preventing SCD. And ICD implantation is the only therapy to show cardiac mortality benefit in HCM patient. Next slide. So according to ACC, class 1 indication is reserved for prior cardiac arrest or sustained VT patient. If it is not present, family history, recent unexplained syncope, wall thickness more than 30, it is a class 2A indication. If it is not present, non-sustained VT and abnormal VT stress response should be seen. These, along with the other features we have discussed, result in a class 2A indication for ICD implantation. If these are not present, ICD implantation is not suggested. Next slide. The ESC suggests a HCM risk variable score, which predicts the 5-year risk. If it is more than 6, we can go for a ICD implantation for primary prevention. Of course, for secondary prevention, this is a class 1 indication. To be noted is that life expectancy of the patient should be more than 1 year. Next slide.
Bashab, come to the conclusion. It's already time.
Quick. So, in lifestyle management, avoidance of alcohol, extremes of temperature, phosphodiesterase inhibitors, digitalis, and vasodilators, and inappropriate diuretics should be taken care of. Next slide. In heart failure patient, we should look for obstruction. If obstruction is not present, atrial fibrillation, irrespective of the CHA2DS2-VAS score, OSC should be given. Nowadays, NOAC is being preferred. Rate control with beta blocker or CCD, non-dihydropyridine. If refractory, then we can go for rhythm control or even catheter ablation. And if the patient is having less than 50% EF, then the management like HEF-REF can be followed. And in terminal patient, LV assist device and cardiac transplantation is to be considered. Next slide. We have already seen beta blockers is the mainstay. Non-dihydropyridine CCDs can be added to it with increased risk of heart blocks. Disopyramide is an alternative to if these two fail, can be used in adjunct. And newer drugs are coming up like paraxylene and aldosterone receptor blockers, which have non-conclusive role till now. Next slide. So syncope in HCM, we have already discussed. Other causes like bradyarrhythmias and reflex syncopes should be looked into with 48-hour Holter monitoring. And the role of ILR is also there if the routine investigation failed to show the arrhythmia. Next slide. So coming, next slide. So coming to septal reduction therapy in class 3-4 symptomatic patients on adequate drug therapy, if the LVOT gradient is more than 50 or if there is an unexplained syncope, we can consider either surgical myectomy or alcohol septal ablation. Young patient, long lifespan, active lifestyle, higher gradient, greater thickness and existing mitral valve disease favor surgical myectomy. However, ASA is equivalent to this modality in elderly comorbid patients according to ESC. Next slide. Role of other devices, dual chamber pacing and cardiac resynchronization in low EF and LVV pattern, only class 2B indication. Next slide. So I would like to end with future directions. T1 mapping, diffusion tensor, cardiac MR to delineate the different etiologies, genetics to target specific populations to detect higher percentage of patients, medical therapy with MRA, ARB and ranolazine, especially patients with angina, and molecular therapy with mavacamten, which is an inhibitor of sarcomeric myosin. Trials are going on to see whether it can be effective in reducing LVOT gradient or LV mass. And invasive therapy, endocardial radio frequency ablation in patients in whom septal ablation cannot be done due to unfavorable coronary anatomy. Thank you.
Can I invite the next speaker, Dr. Somnath Mukherjee, who will be talking about peripartum cardiomyopathy. Again, a very dubious entity.